Oh, well, God is great and greatly to be praised. Glory, glory to his name. God is great and greatly to be praised. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, I know that God is great and greatly to be praised. Glory, glory. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I said that God is great and greatly to be praised. Glory, glory to his name. God is great and greatly to be praised. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, and I will bow before his majesty.
Yeah.
Jesus. Bless that wonderful name. Jesus makes it right. today, Jesus. Let's sing this chorus.
Walker is in the hospital, needs a touch from the Lord. We want to pray this morning that the Lord would minister and give healing to him. It's good to see Sister Ruby in the house of the Lord this morning. We thank the Lord for his touch and help to her. We'll pray, notice Brother Mark Allen in the service this morning. We will pray the Lord would bring a miracle. Sister Mary Miller needs a touch from the Lord this morning. We want to pray for Sister Ruth Flores. They've called hospice, and she needs a miracle from the Lord. We are standing in the presence of a miracle-working God. Brother Josh is in rehab and doing very well. And Sister Brittany was crying on the phone again, just telling me of a doctor that had come back in that had seen him. And there's different individuals that just come to the room, just come to because they know where he was, and they just want to come see Lazarus. They just want to come see a miracle. I don't care what your situation is here this morning. It may seem hopeless. But nothing is impossible with God. Whatever your need is, I want you to step into the aisle right now while we're in the presence of the Lord. Right now, whatever it is, you need a physical touch. You've got a need in your family, whatever it might be. You need the Lord to undertake. We're going to believe the Lord. Amen. I need somebody to agree with every individual that's here. It's taking a step of faith. Step out here and agree with them right now. Step over there and agree with them right now. There's nothing too hard for the Lord. There's nothing so small that He's not concerned. Casting all of your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Father, right now in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus, we're asking you, Lord, to intervene. Touch by your grace and your power for your glory. You see, these that have taken a step of faith, it's not in our abilities. We're believing you, great God of heaven, to make a way where there seems to be no way. You're still the same yesterday, today, and forever. Your arm is not too short that it cannot save. Your ear is not too heavy that it cannot hear our cry. Your eyes are upon us this morning. We're believing you, great God of heaven, to intervene. Destroy the works of the adversary. Bring a recovery, bring a healing, bring a miracle. In that name which is above every name, the name of Jesus. Through the power of the shed blood that still avails today, 2022, that's never lost its power. Grant it, O Lord, arise, let thine enemies be scattered. Grant it, O Lord, for your glory is a testimony of your faithfulness. Lord, provide a miracle, Lord. Minister and meet the need this morning, God. Bring the healing, bring the help, bring the reassurance. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Some of you brethren, gather around Brother Allen, lay hands on him, pray for him this morning. Father, in the name of the Lord, you took the stripes upon your back for our healing, and we're believing you to touch Brother Mark this morning. Hallelujah. Devil, you're a liar and a defeated foe. We stand on the promises of God that are yea and amen to them that believe. Give healing in the name of Jesus. I trust you, Lord. I believe you this morning. I believe you this morning, Lord. I believe you this morning, Lord. For the glory of God. For the glory of God. Hallelujah. 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 God bless the choir as they minister this morning. Good to see Sister Ruth Ann home this morning from her mission. Glad that the Lord kept his hand upon her and brought her safely back. Just continue to worship the Lord this morning. Those that are going to get baptized, if you'll go ahead and get ready, we'll meet you there in just a moment. Hallelujah.
And he took me in. Oh, but you have the love of Jesus. Give God, give him all of the praise. Give God the glory. Give God the glory. Stop you if he can. Oh, but you don't have to give up. But Jesus gives you the victory. We need to give God, give him all of the praise.
Somebody ought to give him the glory this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, choir, for your help this morning in ministry. We're going to ask the ushers to come. I don't know if you're aware of it, but we're in revival. And we're believing the Lord to help us in these services. You will be blessed by the ministry of Brother Jones, friend of mine. And those that are going to get baptized, get ready. We'll meet you there in just a moment. I want you to know that this could be our last time that we get together for church on this side of glory. If you're tired of church, you're in trouble. If you're going to heaven, revival is a foretaste. I said revival is a foretaste in that city where the Lamb is the light, where we'll have church all the time. We'll worship the King all the time. We'll shout and rejoice and sing and praise the King throughout eternity. Glory to God. Tonight, 6 o'clock, invite somebody. Be in the house of the Lord. Tomorrow night at 7. You say, well, I work till 6:30. As soon as you get off work, dust off, come on. Praise God. Well, I'm in my scrubs. Come on. We want you to be here. I'm believing God. It could be that the trumpet could sound Tuesday night. I would hate to stand before the Lord and explain why I wasn't at church when I got off work at 5 o'clock. Do you love his appearing? To them that love his appearing, looking for him, he's going to appear again. And as we see the day approaching, we're to not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, but so much the more as you see the day approaching. I'll never forget a service. I'm just putting a plug in for revival. A guy had been inviting his neighbor to come to church. His neighbor showed up at revival. And he said, I'm not going to call his name because many of you know him. He said, where is he at? I said, well, he should be here in a minute. He never showed up. I called him. He said, well, I was pretty tired and I just didn't make it last night, Pastor. And I said, yeah, and your neighbor showed up. You got to be kidding. I'm so embarrassed. I didn't think he was going to come. You never know who's going to show up. You never know what's going to take place. And I want to be involved in the greatest program this side of heaven. That's the family of God and what he's doing. Father, we thank you for the privilege to be in revival. I pray that you'd bless in this offering. Bless the gift and the giver. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said, amen.
passed in 1994, but I did not stay with God. I had a sinful life during that time. I feel like that He has been with me all along, even though I refused Him at times. I still feel like that He was there to help me through a lot of hard times that I've had. And when I did get baptized in 1994, it was a wonderful experience, but I didn't stay with Him at that time. And for years, I just continued to do my own thing. And now I realize that my ways were not good ways. That everything that I tried to do that was my will, it never turned out. When I came back to Denton, this was where God told me to come back to. And I have loved it ever since. The people are awesome. Everyone is concerned about you. God has stood by me and helped me so much. And I have learned how to study and get closer to Him and do His will. And I decided to be rebaptized because I want, now that I'm doing good and not being sinful, I want to have a clean slate with God. And so I just want to rededicate my life to Him. And I just thank Him for all the things that He's done for me. He's never left me. Even though, as I said before, as I wasn't serving Him, He was still there trying to get me to come to Him. And I'm so glad that He stuck with me and convicted me enough that I came back to Him.
My chains are gone. I've been set free.
Sister Markey, it's wonderful to see the Lord working in your life, what He's done, and what He's going to do. And seeing your family here today, I saw your grandson down there raising his hands while we're singing and worshiping the Lord. And the decisions that we make not only impact us, but they impact our family and those around us. And on the profession of your faith and calling upon the Lord and desirous of following Him in water baptism, to make a statement before the world that the old is being laid to rest and a new creation in Christ is being resurrected, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Josh Little. I've been coming to Faith Tabernacle for about 6 months now. My first visit here was to actually come watch my father, James Little, get baptized. And from that day, God started working on me from day one. I started feeling it. It was emotional. I've been through some trials and tribulations throughout my life, and I was lost for a long time. And my parents worked on me a little bit and got me here, and that's all it took. And seeing Brother Snow for the first time, I didn't really know what to think about him. He's a little wound up, but he kind of grew on me. And as I came more and more, it seemed like every message he had was directed right at me. The songs are emotional. I go down to the front, and just full of emotions, and I see the joy that the individuals have here, and that's what I'm looking for. And I find myself leaving church questioning what I'm doing and why I'm doing things, and I feel like God is working on me, and I'm feeling it more and more each time. And I just think it's time for a big change in my life, and I've asked Jesus to come into my heart and show me the path that God's put forth for me, and I'm just ready to take that next step. And I think that's what the baptism's about. I'm tired of going through the motions. I'm tired of just existing in this world. I want to make a difference, and I think this is the next step for me. So that's why I'm asking for this opportunity to be baptized.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior.
Brother Josh, God is doing some great things in your life, brother. And the best is yet to come. And as you continue to surrender and follow the Lord, He's going to continue to minister to you and through you. And for years, your father stood over there and prayed. And I was calling your name out before I ever met you. But a God who's rich in mercy and grace heard the prayers of a father and a mother, and He's hearing your prayers. And the same God that helped them is going to help you. And on the profession of your faith and desiring to follow after the Lord, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Somebody ought to praise the Lord. Hey, He's still saving. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. One more time. Lift both hands toward heaven and praise Him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless your name. Bless your name. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Brother Brad. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Somebody ought to turn, shake a neighbor's hand, say, man, isn't God doing some great things? Hallelujah. God's doing some great things. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We'll dismiss the children to Children's Church at this time. God bless you, children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. It is a joy this morning to have a friend of mine, Brother Matt Jones, pastors the Great Church Broadway Assembly in Lorain, Ohio. You will be blessed, and I want you to pray with us in this revival, and let's believe the Lord for great things. Brother Jones, we're glad to have you here. Come and take your liberty. Praise the Lord. Love you, brother. Appreciate you. Glory. Hallelujah. If you're saved and you know it, shout amen. Amen. I feel good. I tell my church in Lorraine, a baptismal service is one of my very favorite services. I didn't know what was planned today, but when I was picked up by Brother Snow, he shared with me, amen, the baptismal service slated for this morning, and I just rejoiced in my spirit. Praise God. Then this singing. Wasn't that dynamic? Wow. Folks, I feel there's several ingredients here for revival. Right? I feel the anticipation. I feel the expectation. You're here. Presence of God is here. I believe we all just have church. Huh? Praise God. Wow. And your pastor. What an amazing, remarkable man of God. And your first lady, wherever she may be. He came and preached our spring revival. Was it last year? And called a young man out of the pew to help him one evening. That night changed that young man's life. He testified just not too long ago to me what God did for him that night in that service. It was a turning point in his life and walk with God. And it is still, amen, reaping the benefits and the fruit. Amen. So you've got great, I don't need to tell you that. You know you've got the greatest as far as pastor, your staff. Oh, I'm telling you, what an all-star team here today in this service. Yeah, absolutely. Honor is due. Praise the Lord. Let me just introduce myself. I used to be a Texan. Okay, I'll take that. We lived outside of Dallas for a couple years, and my father, this was back when I was real young, my father worked at the Dowd's Bible plant for some time, and so we got to experience Texas. But it's good to be back. It really is. It really is good to be back, and I'm just trusting the Lord to meet us here. I have a wife. You saw her in the picture. She's not able to be with me. Her mother died a couple years ago, and she's an only child, and we are her father is experiencing some health challenges, and so she felt it best if she stays back home and just kind of looks after him. So that's why she's not able to be with me in this service, but I miss my wife, and we have three children together, 16, 15, and those are the two boys, and then we have a daughter, Caitlin, who is 9 years old. Praise the Lord. I appreciate my family. Amen. And love the fact that when I called Pastor Snow and said that my wife wasn't able to be with me, he said, go ahead and come on. We'll roll with it. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here. Amen. And, you know, aren't you glad for the grace of God? How many's really experienced the grace of God? The grace of God. One little boy in Sunday school explained justice, mercy, and grace like this. He said, if a cop pulls you over for speeding and gives you a ticket, that's justice. If a cop pulls you over for speeding and gives you a warning, that's mercy. But if a cop pulls you over for speeding and gives you a Krispy Kreme donut, that is grace. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody is thankful for the grace of God. Let's stand together. Amen. Take your Bibles. Join with me in the book of Job, Job 42. The accommodations have been super. You've treated me like a king already. Had some breakfast this morning right by the waterfall. It was just amazing. Amen. This morning, I just want to be a voice of encouragement as we get started here in our revival. And so I'm going to share with you from Job 42 and verse 10. It's
Scripture says, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. And also the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job. I want to talk to you this morning about pivot points. Pivot points. Father, thank you for this great opportunity to be with this fine church family. I pray that you open our eyes to see your truth, our ears to hear your voice, and our minds to understand your word. Glorify yourself through my efforts. Make me heaven's mouthpiece, we pray. In Jesus' name, all God's people shout amen. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated. By definition, the word pivot simply means to change direction. Lately, I've read various news articles as well. I know you have commentators detailing how there's current national situations in our nation that we would probably need to pivot if we are going to continue to be the nation that we have known and loved. But the underlying belief is that leaders and nations can pivot. They can change directions. But not only can governments pivot, as nations can pivot, families can pivot. Churches can pivot, as well as individuals. There are positive pivots. There are negative pivots. First, I'd like for us to think of some common pivot points we see every day. For example, in sports like football, we know that a fumble recovery or a pass interception or an injured player can prove to be a pivotal point in the game. In war, a decisive battle or major offensive can prove to be a pivotal point at which the outcome of the war is decided. There's also pivotal points in our health conditions. Many times, an illness can be a pivot point. Many people have described a recent diagnosis as a pivot point in their life. I'm reminded of my brother who was 15 years older than I. He was born with a hole in his heart. The doctor said if he has not undergone surgery, he would never be able to fully develop and gain weight. He was 4 years old. They decided to do that open heart surgery. They had a student doctor in there, unfortunately, administering too much blood thinner. Once they performed the surgery, sewed him back together, he was losing blood faster than they could administer it. They come down and told my family, we're not able to do much. It's very critical. Mom and Dad went into the hospital chapel and began to pray. Hallelujah. How many know we've got a great physician? They came down an hour later. Gave the same story. 2 hours later, the same story. Finally, there was a place, my mother said, while she was on her face travailing in prayer in that hospital chapel, she felt God come into the room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. She said that point proved pivotal to her. Right there, she surrendered and she said, God, if you take my baby boy, I'm going to live for you. If you'll leave my baby boy and I'll raise him for you. But either way, he's yours and I'm yours. She said no longer. Just a minute or two after that, that same nurse that had come in there and gave him bad news like 2 or 3 times in a row, come in there and said, you can see your boy now. He's in recovery. I'm talking about a God that's able. Had a sister 2 years older than I. She was born with phenylketonuria, 23% poison in her blood. When the blood travels to the brain, It cancels brain cells. They said she would never be able to walk or talk or feed herself or comprehend anything. They brought her home from the hospital. Mom and Dad said, what did the Bible say in the book of James? Call the elders of the church. As she laid in the crib, the elders of the church came in, laid their hands and prayed the prayer of faith. And one of the gentlemen said, told my mom, said, Mom, I just saw a light shine through her body. She's going to be okay. Took her back to the doctors. They run the tests. They couldn't explain it, but they said, here's what happened before. This is what the test showed. Now the tests are reading this way. She is. Praise God. Her and I went to Bible school together. She became valedictorian, and you know where that left me. I wasn't even into running. I'm talking about pivot points. There comes a place, to be honest, there are many pivot points in my life that I would consider pivotal moments where the before and the after are markedly different. Probably one of the biggest is the moment I said I do to my wife, right? My life before my wife and after my wife, very different. I found out, Pastor, that the voice of God sounds a lot like the voice of my wife. We better move on. But I like this phrase, the Lord turned the captivity of Job. That was the pivot point in the entire book of Job. This turning enabled Job to pivot past his past. It does not say God turned his poverty, though Job had been reduced to extreme poverty. We don't read that God turned his sickness, though he was covered with boils. Listen, a man may be very poor and yet not be in captivity. His soul can still sing even when his body is being licked by the dogs, as in Job's case. A man can be very sick and yet not be in captivity. But I believe the captivity here referred to in this text was a mental bondage, a torment of mind. I imagine that Job was under a severe mental trial that accompanied his physical and his family and his materialistic loss. And this mental aspect was one of the worst parts that he probably had to deal with. Sickness of body is one thing. Sickness of mind is another thing. And listen, but we know Job remained faithful. And so Scripture says that God turned. Hallelujah. And listen, but we know, I don't know about you, but that just, I like the sound of that. And I found that the original Hebrew means, when it says God turned the captivity, it means he put a stop to all the evil. Oh, hallelujah. I said he put a stop to all the evil. Listen, when God turns captivity, as he did with Job, you never see Satan consuming, destroying, or devouring anything of Job's ever again. The Lord turned the captivity of Job, and the Lord restored to Job twice as much. Somebody say twice as much. Now, if God had read Webster's definition of restoration, he would have brought Job back to the original condition. But God's restoration program means increase. It means multiply. It means improve. Look at Job's original condition. His substance, the scripture says, was 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the east. That's the original condition. That's not bad. I say he's living pretty good. Maybe if Job was alive today, he would be a Texan. Sounds like a pretty good sized ranch for Texas. Right? But then Satan comes and consumes and destroys and devours everything. But guess what? Don't you stop reading until you read this part. God begins a restoration program. And listen, notice when God restored, he didn't take Job back to his original condition. And there's a lot of people who would be satisfied with being taken back to the original condition. But that's not God's way. God's way is extravagant. God's way is far above, exceedingly and abundantly above all that you could ask or think. Listen, that's what God does. He does everything big. He's not wasteful, but he's extravagant. Yeah. And God says, devil, you stole from one of my children. Now it's time for restoration. Somebody say a pivot point. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. Now instead of 7,000 sheep, he's got 14,000 sheep. Instead of 3,000 camels, he's got 6,000 camels. Instead of five, listen, I'm not a prosperity preacher, but I can tell you, you be faithful to God. I said you stay faithful to God. There will come a pivot point in your life.
Yeah, but brother, that took a lifetime.
Oh, no.
Theologians agree that the 42 chapters of Job doesn't cover his entire life. They said all that happened in anywhere from 9 to 12 months. Obviously, not all of his children being restored back during that time. But that's not his whole life in our book. And a lot of people read it and they think, oh dear God, look what this man went through in his life. No, he went through all of that in about 9 to 12 months. Huh? It's the worst 9 to 12 months you could ever read about. But keep reading. It becomes the best 9 to 12 months you could read about. A man is the wealthiest in all the East. He loves God. He's in right standing with God, serving God. But the enemy comes. Listen, friend, how many's found out the enemy comes to destroy everything. But when God got through restoring him, he's not just the wealthiest man in all the East. Nobody is even close to him. I said, I like God's way of restoration. I said, I like God's way of revival. It can happen in our life too. When God turns our captivity, he restores what the locust have eaten, what the cankerworm hath eaten. Faith Tabernacle, God did not bring you this far to forget or forsake you. He has too much invested in you, and he's not going to give up on you now. Let me tell you, Satan doesn't control your destination. Hell doesn't have the power to stop you or to keep you down. You may be in the midst of the greatest battle of your life, but listen, there's a turning on its way. There's a pivot point coming. And my friend, I want to tell somebody, your destination, I said your destination is going to be greater than your disaster. Somebody shout amen.
Praise God. If Job was here today, he'd tell us that a setback doesn't mean it's over.
Hallelujah.
I said a setback doesn't mean it's over. An ending only means that there's getting ready to be a new beginning. Oh, somebody needs that new beginning this morning. The road to victory always consists of endings and beginnings, setbacks and comebacks. And if you're experiencing a setback at this present time, I want you to get ready to experience a comeback. God has a pivot point in this service with your name on it.
Listen, Job experienced major loss, but in the end, Lord, hallelujah, he blessed him. His destiny was greater than his disaster. I want to tell somebody in the house today, God's going to bring you out. I said, God's going to bring you out. He brought Joseph out of the pit. He brought Israel out of Egypt. He brought Daniel out of the den. God brought the three Hebrew children out of the fire. He's going to bring you out. Somebody say, weeping may endure for the night, but guess what? I said, guess what? Joy cometh in the morning. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Now thanks be unto God, which causes us to triumph. How many things do we conquer, believers? All. How often do we triumph? Always. Huh? I know it's a hard thing to process and understand. I know in the natural we cannot figure it out. But the truth is, God can take what looks like a curse. Hello? And turn it into a blessing. Huh? He will take what the enemy meant for evil and turn it. Oh, somebody say, it's my pivot point. Regardless of what you go through, regardless of what you face, there is a promise. All things are going to work together for the good. Say it with me, to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. If we could understand his purpose, the problem wouldn't drive us crazy. But listen, if we'll stay true in the hard times, God will use that adversity. He will make advancements with it. Our disappointments will become God appointments. Our opposition will open doors of opportunity because there is not a pit too deep. There's not a fire too hot. There's not a storm powerful enough. There's not a chain strong enough. Then nothing can hold us back. Because though Adam, we was born a victim. But thank God for the second Adam, Jesus Christ. There's victory. I said there's victory in the house.
Can I tell somebody, you're not an accident?
Woo! You're not a mistake. Before time began, you were part of God's plan. You were chosen with Christ before the foundation of the world. Newsflash, the people that are not going through anything are probably some of the people that are not going anywhere. Huh? If David hadn't been destined to be king, he wouldn't have to have run from Saul for 10 years for his life. If Joseph hadn't had the promise of the palace, he would have never had to go into the pit and then into the prison. If Israel had never been on her way to a promised land, she would not have had to go through the fire and through the flood. But just as the fire and the water could not stop Israel, the trial and the affliction or the setback that you are experiencing cannot stop you, because God brought Israel out of Egypt, Joseph out of the pit, Daniel out of the den. Our destiny is greater than our disaster. Raise your hands and pray. I feel the Holy Ghost right here. Feel some anticipation. I gotta hurry. But everything God has promised, don't you let the enemy talk you out of it. Numbers 23:19. God's not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, shall he not do it? Hath he spoken, shall he not make it good? God's word will not return void. Isaiah 55:11, I will hasten my word to perform it, he told Jeremiah. Listen, Satan knows if he can keep you in your past, you will never move to your future.
And that's why he spends so much time talking about your yesterdays. Huh? Did you notice Satan doesn't ever talk about your tomorrow? Huh? God is the only one who discusses our tomorrow, not the devil. Listen, don't build your future around your past. Huh? Focus on your tomorrow and not your yesterday. Talk about your future, not your past. Hallelujah. Don't dwell on where you were yesterday. Dwell on where God is going to take you. I said where he's going to take you. It's your future, your destiny. Satan wants to keep you from entering it. Everything you're going through, the battles and the afflictions and the tests and the setbacks and the strange trials and the abnormal hindrances that you are experiencing, everything you're going through is the enemy trying to keep you from your destination in God. Satan wants you to lose focus. He wants you to become discouraged and keep. Listen, friends, don't get your eyes off the prize. I said, don't you get your eyes off the front. Listen, quit looking at what you're going through and begin to look at where you're going, where God's taking you. I said, there's a pivot point, and you can pivot past your past because your destination is going to be great. Woo. Now look, praise God. I've got to hurry. Pastor, you didn't give me a time. But I'm looking at the time. Listen, if the devil could have killed you yesterday, he would have did that. Huh? But he didn't succeed then. He's not going to succeed now. Huh? Because he is a liar. And the father of lies. He's telling somebody, you're not going to get anything in this meeting. You're not going to get revival. You're not going to experience restoration. I want you to tell him. Listen, David shouted it in the mouth of hell in Psalm 118. I shall not die, but shall live and declare the works of the Lord. Look at what you've already been through. Look at the mess you've already walked through. Look at what you had to go through to get to where you are. Listen, somebody say, I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. Others, I'm telling you folks, some folks would have already lost their minds. Huh? Others would have given up and never made it, but not you. God chose you, and you chose God. You're alive today not because of good luck. You didn't make it through everything you've been through because you carried a rabbit's foot in your pocket. Huh? You are a survivor because God, if God be for you, who can be against you? And like David said in Psalm 124, if it had not been for the Lord who is on my side, when men rose up against me, then they had swallowed me up quick. When their wrath was kindled, then the waters had overwhelmed us. The stream had gone over my soul. Listen, if the devil would have had his way, you wouldn't be here this morning. I said, you would not be here this morning. If your enemies would have had their way, you would not be here this morning. You've been lied on. You've been betrayed. You've been slandered. You've been falsely accused. And nothing planned against you has worked. Because Isaiah 54 says, for God's people, no weapon. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Even when you were out of God's will, his hand was upon you. He had a plan for you. And even though you've not reached your destiny as of yet, you need to tell the devil, I'm well on my way. Oh, somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to praise him. That's it, brother. God's a working right over here. I know I got to hurry, but I don't want to miss the voice of God. Somebody's going to experience a pivot point in this house. Is this okay, Pastor? Somebody over here is going to experience a pivot point. That brother and sister that got baptized this morning. You know why they got in that baptismal tank? You know why they testified? It's because they knew there was a pivot point in their life. You're not going to talk them out of that pivot point, brother. They've experienced it firsthand. Listen, there's not a demon in hell that... Hallelujah. Listen, friends. My little children, if any man sin, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. That's what 1 John 2:1 says. His mercies are new every morning. Mistakes are correctable. Sin is forgivable. God's favor is accessible. David failed God, but he repented and received God's forgiveness, becoming one of the greatest kings of Israel. Samson failed God. But he cried out to God in trouble. He repented. And he did more in his death than he did in his life. Huh? I'm telling somebody, Peter failed God miserably. He even denied knowing Christ. But he received forgiveness and was used by God, rising up and standing on the day of Pentecost. Preaching in 3,000 souls. Hallelujah. Somewhere there was a pivot point. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody, your pivot point can be this morning. Why don't you raise your hands right where you're at? Lord is speaking this morning. If they want to come to the music, they can do so. The writer in Psalm 126 said it this way, when the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then he says, then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things among them. Turn again. The next verse says, turn again our captivity, O Lord. As the streams in the south, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. pivot point. Somebody is going to sing again. I said, somebody is going to worship again. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody is going to praise the name of the Lord again. You've sowed in tears, but a pivot point is just ahead. You're going to start reaping in joy. He'll give you beauty for ashes. You can stand to your feet. I'm going to close. The oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, if you will pivot past your past. As Psalm 126 says, even the enemies are going to have to admit the Lord hath done great things among us. Wouldn't that be great? The devil tried to make you give up. He probably fought you even trying to get here this morning. Even some church people might have thought you was a little crazy. Your enemies laughed at you for staying faithful. You could have given up, but you refused. I'm talking to somebody right here. Against all odds, you stood and you believed for a miracle that Pastor was talking about earlier. We serve a miracle-working God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. One has come. Is there another? Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I feel the Holy Spirit. Church, we're Pentecostal around here. I already know that. I felt that. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Do you know Haggai 2:9 said, the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord of hosts. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want you to come, and why don't you say, Jesus, perform it in me. That's it. That's it. Perform it in me. Jesus, help yourself to my past. Help yourself to my present. Help yourself to my future. One thing for sure, help me to pivot. This morning, I'm going to pivot in this revival. The first day of this revival, it is my pivot point. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Of this very thing, he which hath begun a good work will perform it. Somebody shall perform it in me, Jesus. Perform it in me, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. My God says, wait, it ain't over.
up